everyone. I hope you can see and hear us. I'm Philip, CMO at Project A. And my next guest, as David Letterman would say, needs no introduction. I'll give a short one anyhow. He's the future mayor of Hamburg, at least I hope. He's also a regular on the OMR podcast. You might know him from there. He's been the CMO of the year last year. And as a little side hustle, so to speak, he's building the first unicorn out of Hamburg as co-founder of About You. Very happy to have you here on stage, Tarek, and the word is yours.
Hey, thanks for the introduction. You know, I founded a couple of companies before About You, also some B2B companies, yeah, and our motto was always under promise, over deliver. So Philip made it quite hard for me to over deliver after such an introduction. Nevertheless, I hope you're going to enjoy the next 40 minutes. I will speak a bit about how About You has managed to build a mass market brand. And I would start with a small introduction of who we are and afterwards jump into the slides regarding the topic. So let's start. The topic of the presentation, I hope you all know this, and not kind of by accident ran into this session, is winning the attention and hearts of the young audience, how to build a mass market brand. About You has managed to build a mass market brand. In Germany, we have a higher brand awareness than Zalando, and within the young audience, especially young girls, we are the most well-known online fashion brand. And we did not just achieve this in Germany, but by now we are active in 16 countries. As you can see here, our country rollout in most of the countries, actually, we have an even higher brand awareness than we have in Germany. Because back then when we started in Germany, we were heavily underfinanced, and I think we did a lot of stuff wrong, like looking back now, having all the learnings and data together. And luckily, we can basically... we have a new game basically every year, a couple of times with new countries we start. And by over the course of the last 6 years, we have optimized the way we built up our brand from zero. Every year we start from zero in different countries. And this has not just basically improved the playbook we have in order to launch new countries, but it also has also allowed us to test a lot. For example, in a couple of countries, we just did no TV. In other countries, we did no social media for a year or when starting, in order to basically see what the effects are. And we have a lot of other basically measures on how to gain learnings on which what works, what not. We still grow. We still grow geographically. So this is a bit of an old chart here. By now, we have added 4 new countries. So 5 new countries. Now we're active in 21 countries. This year we will achieve something around 3.5 billion in gross merchandise volume and around 1.2 billion milliarden in IFRS net revenue. We are profitable in the DACH region since 2019, so the German speaking area, and we are market leader in 10 out of the 16 countries. We are active in the remaining 6 countries, Zalando's market leader. Within continental Europe, we are the second largest online fashion player after Zalando. Our mission or vision is to digitize the offline shopping stroll for fashion. So we want to inspire our customers and basically invite them to take an online shopping stroll, mainly on their smartphone. We want to support people by finding and expressing themselves through personality, their personality through fashion, because we believe fashion is kind of a language, and we want to become the global number one in fashion. So that's it from the About You field. I hope that gave you a small impression of who we are. From a business model perspective, actually, I've missed to explain this. We are basically like Zalando, if you know Zalando. So it's a fashion online shop, yeah, a bit cooler, younger, more on inspiration, more smartphone-driven, more personalized, exclusive assortment. But, you know, if you would put us into, if you're looking for peers for About You, for those who are not living in the countries we're active in, it would be ASOS and Zalando. So how was this journey possible? I would like to start with a small recap of former times. 10 years ago, when you would have to decide for one channel in terms of marketing to build up your brand, you would definitely have picked TV. So until I would say 5 years ago, but for sure 10 years ago, TV was the mass market, mass marketing channel. If you would have heavily penetrated TV, my hypothesis would be just through TV advertisement. Let's say you're penetrating TV over the course of 5 years with 100 million plus gross budget in a country. My hypothesis, you would gain 90% brand awareness back then, 10 years ago. So TV was the number one channel, the number one focus for creative agencies, for media agency. Everybody was very much narrowed on focusing on how to optimize TV. Nowadays, I believe within the last 5 years, the importance of TV as a channel for brand building is massively declining, especially for the young audience. And by young audience, I mean 18 to 29, or I would even say by now it's 18 to 35. For sure, 18 to 29, pretty sure 18 to 35, not long until it's 18 to 39. So I think whatever I say will be true for even older target groups within the next years. Even with heavy advertising penetration, so taking that example, 5 years heavy TV penetration, 100 million plus gross budget over the course of 5 years, we believe you can reach a maximum of 25% via TV in the target group 18 to 29. So coming from 90% potential of TV built brand awareness to 25% within a couple of years. I know that the TV stations would now say that is not true because the usage of TV has not declined as massively as this numbers show. And that's actually partially true. Young people still watch TV. Nevertheless, TV usage has declined. But there is also another reason why you can't build this massive brand awareness nowadays as it was possible in 10 years ago. The reason is, and everybody who has basically observed a young person while sitting in front of the TV is, young people watch TV explicitly. So they don't come home and then, watch whatever is running in the television, as I did, to be honest, 15 years ago when I came from school. Yeah, I laid myself on the couch. There was no smartphone in my hand, and so I just turned on the TV and I was just looking whatever was there. Yeah, and I was looking at the television actually. So I was randomly watching TV. So nowadays, young people don't randomly watch TV anymore, and they always have their smartphone at hand. So they explicitly watch TV for watching a certain content, for example, live content, which still works also in young audience, live content in linear television. But during TV break, during advertising breaks, they don't look at the television. And I think, everyone saying something else, I mean, must be blind. It is just the fact that I would say 95% of young people sitting in front of the television don't look at the television at the advertising break. So basically, you are paying reach for reach. That is basically like, it could be the metaphor in the online world would be, you're paying reach even though someone uses an ad blocker. So, the reach is measured from the TV station. The reach is measured by people sitting in front of the TV, but that is not the metric anymore. The metric must be how many people of those who are sitting in front of you actually looking at the TV, because everything else can be seen as an ad blocker. The smartphone in the hand of a young person is kind of an ad blocker, and we are paying for this. And I believe, from the first reason maybe explains why the drop could be seen as from 90 to, let's say, 70. But the second aspect is the larger basically effect of the two, and that explains the drop to 25%. And we have measured this now in several cases, that you can't go above 25% because young people are just not following TV advertisement anymore. So how do we close the gap? We see this pie chart as becoming true. Oh, by the way, that being said, we are still doing TV advertisement, yeah, because you are still reaching an old audience. Whatever I just said, forget it if you are serving an audience above 35. TV still is a good channel. Yeah, I'm not saying TV is a horrible channel. TV is a good channel if you do TV advertisement right. It is still performing. You can still, you know, generate a positive ROI. And you are still also building massive brand awareness significantly above 50% at the old audience. And they are also converting. So TV in general is not a bad channel. Yeah. But TV is not this number one, you know, major channel as it was in former days. And if I would now have to decide for one channel, you know, I would not pick TV anymore if my audience is below age of 39, because it's just not the most important brand awareness channel for this audience anymore. So what is the most important brand awareness channel? It's social media, because the active social media usage of young audience is extremely high. And if you do it right, you gain the attention of the young audience and don't fall in the same trap as in TV. They might be sitting in front of the TV, they are ignoring your advertisement, but if you do it right, you can build decent brand awareness just with ads. This is the 15% of this pie chart, our Facebook, Insta story ads. Yeah. But most importantly, what we see as most important is kind of the storytelling via social. So the basically organic reach. I'm putting organic in question marks because it's not organic since you pay people to post something about you, but kind of fake organic reach you can gain through social media. But this is also the hardest part. And this is the part I will focus on. The 35% of this pie chart in the next couple of slides, since I believe, you know, how to do TV advertisement, you know, it's pretty clear. How to do social media ads is also pretty clear. Then there's this large other bucket, you know, consisting of several activities. Don't want to go into detail because of time here. So storytelling via social is the part I'm going to focus on for the next 20 minutes. Okay, I see there are also already coming questions in. I will try to rush through the slides to have at least 10-15 minutes for questions at the end. So we believe you need to at least target or set the goal of transforming yourself from advertiser to storyteller and story creator. And by this, basically, brands become entertainment and media companies as well. And I think building up the capability of being an entertainment and a media company becomes increasingly important. We see this on three pillars. First of all, publishing. We are running an online shop. We have a website there. We want people to access our website organically. And we see that the largest lever in order to get people organically visit your website and not via Google or whatever is to have exclusive and great content on your website. Stuff people don't find anywhere else. This was the breakthrough for Netflix. Netflix was just a random stream service until they came up with exclusive content. And then you had to get Netflix because you just wanted to see House of Cards. And there was just no alternative. So, you know, this is the strongest USP you can build, I believe, to gain organic and recurring loyal customer is to offer them something they won't find anywhere else. Because then it's not about price anymore. Then it's not about, you know, doing great Google marketing or whatever. You know, it is just a very, very clear USP you have. Obviously, you need to make yourself need to make yourself aware. So here we see two pillars. First of all, storytelling. So we try to work a lot with influencers together with brands, PR, whatever, people to multiplicate whatever we do in the very right bucket of story creating. So we have a database of more than 10,000 influencers gathering all the data we can get about them. And then deciding on whatever we have to tell, we pick the right influencers basically to tell it. And I can tell you it's also not just, you know, picking the right one, paying the right price, which I think most of the things a lot of advertisers do wrong, but it's also the way how you tell it. But you also need to have something to tell. And this is the right bucket, the story creating. We strongly believe you need to create meaningful experiences, exclusive content pieces, you know, stuff that is worth being spread via social media. Because no matter, I mean, if you obviously can pay people to tell a boring story, but it will be still a boring story. So it's not the lever is not finding someone who tells your story, an influencer you pay, but it's, you know, also pay telling the right story that will create emotions at the kind of end user that is seeing the story being told by a third party. So what do we mean by this threefold strategy? So first of all, publishing, pretty clear, as said, exclusive content on our website. We are by now by far the largest fashion magazine in Germany and also in Europe. I mean, in Europe by far. We have 30 million monthly active users on About You, and 80% of them are visiting About You organically, and most of them via the app. So no reactivation costs for them. And we are running by now more than 1,000 influencer corporations every month. And as said, we have this database of more than 10,000 influencers, where we crawl a lot. You know, we gather a lot of data, and out of those 10,000, we pick around 500 to 1,000 every month to do corporations. We also do corporations together with external brands. For, of course, our fashion suppliers here, Levi's, Nike, Adidas, for example, but there are dozens more. But also external brands like Lufthansa, Toyota, Got2Be, and several other brands we are running basically co-productions with in order to also tell our story or the joint story and you know, make use of the joint reach we have. In terms of story creating, we see this on two pillars. First of all, large scale events. Here are three examples for events we are hosting. The About You Awards, it's an event and a TV show at the same time, an entertainment show. The About You Awards is basically the Oscars for the influencer scene. So it's an award show, as the name says. 1,500 people are on the ground. Most of them influencers, obviously, multiplicating this to millions of people through social media, basically, whatever they can experience offline here. And then this show is also aired on ProSieben. As said, people still watch TV, but they explicitly watch TV for the content and not for the TV break. That's why we also stream this on ProSieben. And we also get money for this from ProSieben as a kind of nice side effect. And this show was followed by 800,000 people in the television. And then we had another 2.5 million people watching that show on the online streaming services of the television stations and YouTube. And on social media, we reached an additional 10 million unique people, reaching them more than 30 seconds, and for sure having logo and brand contact with About You. So massive reach. Just through an event and a TV show. But not easy. It took us 4 years to build this. We have the About You Fashion Week. It's a 5 days or 3 days, 3 to 5 days event where we open the Fashion Week for the public. So you as an end consumer can buy a ticket for 11 euro and then follow a fashion show, which usually you can't because it's a B2B thing. And then there's a lot happening offline. It's a cool offline event. You see a lot of stations, a bit like Disneyland for, you know, fashion addicts. You can run from booth to booth where you can experience stuff from our brand partners. You can follow a fashion show. You get a nice goodie bag, et cetera, et cetera. But you also need to pay for that. That is always important for us to have events and TV shows that are financing themselves. So everything we do has a refinancing model in it. Obviously, first of all, through co-sponsoring from our brand partners, but also through either ticketing we sell to the people coming, license fees we get from streaming services or television stations that are airing our shows. Because we believe, you know, if nobody's willing to pay for it, it's not great content. Great content will always find someone who finances it. And that is for us always a very important benchmark, and to always do stuff that refinances itself at least to a certain extent. And then we have the About You Pangea Festival, for example, as the third major event in Germany. It's a fashion and lifestyle festival. Last year we had 15,000 attendees here again. They paid an average 130 euro for their ticket. So it was great content and not kind of branded shit that was for free, and that's why people came. It was great festival priced at the same level, on the same level as others were priced, so no discounting here. And also great festival combining music and fashion. On the story creating part, we, as said, have the About You Awards as a television show. We have About You Does Fashion Duel. All About You Does Fashion Duel is kind of a similar thing to Shopping Queen for those who are from Germany, and Style Your Style It's About You. Both was aired 10 weeks, every week one episode. Does Fashion Duel, for example, was aired at the same time as Shopping Queen, and 7 out of 10 times it has had a higher market share than Shopping Queen. And there we can all again see it was a very successful show. We also, you know, create documentaries together with our celebrity partners whom we are doing collections with. And this is also a way of basically promoting their fashion brand, which we co-created with them, and that is exclusively sold on About You. So we have a high interest of promoting their fashion brand, because if people want to buy their fashion brand, they need to buy it on About You. And this, for example, we also do through, for example, a documentary. To mention one example here, we did a fashion brand together with Bill Kaulitz from Tokyo Hotel, being exclusively sold on About You, MDLA. And we did a 3-episode documentary about him basically transforming him from a musician to a designer. And we sold this documentary to Joyn, third largest streaming service in Germany. And it was great advertising, because a lot of people were watching that that show. The 3rd episode was taking place on our About You Fashion Week. He was, you know, telling about the cooperation with About You, et cetera, et cetera. So I can, is for sure, if you were watching those 3 episodes, for sure, you know About You afterwards. For sure, you know About You, you're considering About You, because you were, you know, massively, basically, there was a massive push on this message of About You being a great fashion online shop, having exclusive assortment. Without saying this, it was implicitly clear that we are a fashion shop and that we are selling exclusive assortment, and that if you like what you see in terms of fashion, you need to go to About You and buy it there. So this was implicit, basically, messaging, but messaging that is much, much more sustainable than a TV advertisement, because the emotional attachment you have and the implicit messaging makes sure that you also still remember us in a year. And what we could see for TV advertisement, or even more for example, radio advertisement, is people can recognize or might recognize your brand a day later or a week later, but for sure they will forget you within a month or a year if you don't follow up with more advertisements. So basically the time until people forget about you is quite short for classical advertisement. Yeah, people can't remember this for a long time, because they were not emotionalized when learning about your brand. If they visit an event of you, if they follow a TV show of you, or an entertainment show, or documentary, or whatever, or they see your favorite influencer promoting about you on a very cool way and not a shitty, obviously paid way, basically, for sure, you will remember about you much longer than through a classical television spot. So what does it take for brands to create stories? First of all, obviously, great ideas, yeah, authentic stories, real protagonists, real emotions, real experiences, unforgettable memories. I know this is such a bullshit bingo on the left-hand side, yeah, but it is true. You need to do these things, and they really need to be authentic. You can't fake this, and you need to have real experiences and unforgettable memories. Everything else is just a shitty story. It's like a shitty TV spot. It won't work. It's not just about the reach you generate through social. It's also about the messaging you get. And I think it's even more important to set the right messaging in social media than it was in television. Yeah, because in television, it was clear that this is advertisement. In social, if you do it right, it's not seen as advertisement. Yeah, if you do it wrong, it's seen as, what the fuck? Why is this brand disturbing my nice social media channel here? So it can be even more negative than a bad television TV spot. Yeah, so it is important to have great ideas, and it is important to not lie to yourself about how great your idea is. And companies tend to do this, us as well. That's why we always look for someone co-sponsoring us the idea, because then you have ultimate external proof if this idea is really great, or if this idea is just, you know, promoting whatever you want to get promoted. Yeah. And you need budget. I mean, what I often experience is, you know, people say, "Oh, Tarek, that sounds nice. Cool. We're going to test it out." And what they do is, you know, they go to their marketing department and say, "Look, I saw this speech from Tarek yesterday. You know, we need to generate real emotions, real whatever. And you have $50,000 budget for it." I'm always like, what the fuck? Like, imagine you would be running a TV campaign with fucking 50,000 euro. You couldn't even create a nice TV spot. I mean, it's also about budget. Not everything that is digital or at the end digital means it can be run with low budgets. Performance marketing, yes. If you are running a Facebook ad or a Google ad and you have a bad performance with 5,000 euro, it won't get better with 100,000. Yeah, it will get worse. So for performance marketing, it's pretty true. You can test performance marketing channels with low budgets and it won't get much better. This stuff can't be done with low budgets. It can't be done with R&D and it takes a learning curve. See this as TV advertisement. TV advertisement, you need a great television spot. It takes time until you are able to create a great TV spot, and it takes fucking media budgets. If you invest 10,000 euro into television, yeah, advertisement, you will be aired at 2 o'clock on RTL2. Yeah, nobody cares. You won't see any effect. Same happens if you go with two less budgets into a story creating, and nobody cares. It will just fly under the radar and it will be just like thrown out money. Yeah. So if you believe in those things, invest decent money and not play around with 10,000 euro. It won't change anything. So I already said that we are always co-funding our projects. We are always onboarding other brand partners, and we are always creating kind of an umbrella event to also let other brand partners be part of our brand experiences. And we also always try to make sure that they have a positive ROI of this as well, because we couldn't do this without the co-financing of our brand partners. And that's why it's always very important for us to make it a good deal for them as well. We measure these initiatives on CPM, basically to benchmark this with classical advertisement like TV, radio, outdoor, print, etc. So other channels you could build your brand awareness. We always normalize this on a qualified advertising context. As said, we don't believe that everyone sitting in front of the television is actually taking notes of your advertisement. So we have run several market research studies on how many people are actually following the TV advertisement. And we don't just take the CPM the TV station is telling us, but we always normalize this. But we also normalize Instagram reach, for example. So, I mean, this is no secret here, but the number of followers an influencer has is not the reach he has, yeah, or she has. So you need to normalize basically every channel to have a fair, basically, apple-to-apple comparison and not compare two wrong basically reach numbers with each others. And that's why kind of the magic here is basically in the normalization. And we always run marketing mix models and try to, basically measure as much as we can in terms of direct impact on brand awareness, correlation between brand awareness and consideration on direct traffic and revenue, so basically come up with a lot of things on how to at the end of the day get an ROI, because brand awareness is not something you do for the sake of being brand aware, but at the end of the day you always need to translate everything into sales. But we know for our industry at least, having a high brand awareness, high consideration and top of mind share leads to revenue. And what we did was basically re-engineering revenue to top of mind consideration and brand awareness as a funnel. And by this, basically having a KPI in mind on how much do we want to invest for 1% point of brand awareness. Brand awareness drives direct traffic, but obviously, and I have to say this as basically an online marketing child. Yeah. So my background, I would say, is online marketing. Yeah. But it's just, if at all half of the secret sauce, performance marketing is obviously still another key to efficiently scale revenues, but it is much easier to scale performance marketing on the back of a well-positioned and well-known brand. We don't have enough time to jump into these topics. We had about you very much about data and automation of online marketing initiatives. If you want to learn more about this, feel free. I got a podcast together with OMR called Think with Tarek. It's unfortunately on German, but there are two episodes where Alexander, our director of marketing, and me are talking about how we have built up the performance marketing setup at About You, how do we integrate basically what we call MIT, marketing intelligence and technology, in order to have the right decisions in whatever we spend. Yeah. So if you're interested in this, feel free to listen to the Think with Tarek podcast. That's it from my side. Feel free to ask questions. I will try to answer as many as possible.
Great. Perfect. Thank you so much, Tarek. Very passionate, especially about the TV part and especially about going big when it comes to brand awareness. I think we, for the sake of clarity, we have 360 people in the stream, so I won't give the mic to anybody if you don't mind. Let's rather do the questions via chat. I think that's more efficient. I liked one more on the TV side, which was not the focus of the talk, but anyhow, from Vincent. He asked, what about smart TV? Do you think in terms of reach, it's something noteworthy or looking into already, or is it simply not a relevant channel at this point?
I think in terms of reach, it's not. I mean, you know, smart TV would be a great thing in order to get proper data on how many people are actually sitting in front of the TV, because I believe that number is already quite biased. And, you know, the television stations are not doing any effort in changing the way they measure reach. Yeah, they still in Germany reach this through fucking 5,000 people in Germany, 5,000 households having that fucking box in their home, you know, and that is then being, you know, calculated to the population. But I mean, how crazy is the bias in this? I mean, who the fuck is putting such a box into his home, not getting paid? And if you're sitting in front of the television, you have next to your TV remote control, you have another remote control where you need to tell the box how many people are sitting in front of the television. I mean, what kind of adverse selection is this? Yeah. I mean, nobody who's not watching television will put this fucking box in their house. I mean, it's pretty clear. Yeah. So, you know, smart TV would be a great way to measure real reach. Unfortunately, TV stations are not doing any effort. Then the television or the advertisement on, you know, the kind of the targeting, etc., is often priced so high that we felt the CPM is so high that it's not worth the investment, actually. That's why we still, you know, do the classical linear advertisement on low budgets and not do kind of the targeted smart TV advertisement so far.
All right. And there were a couple of questions regarding the team that's behind this. I think in the podcast episode that you referred to, you're giving some clarity on that, but maybe you can give us the short version here, especially when it comes to the branding side of things, probably. It's interesting to know, how big is the team? Who's involved? Do you work with agencies at all when it comes to that, or do you do everything in-house?
Yeah. So we have in-housed everything by now. So media strategy and purchasing is in-house. Also creation is in-house and production. Nevertheless, in some of the countries, especially for the first 2 years, we are always working with a local media agency to get an understanding of the local, basically, media environment. But we steer this in-house, and it's a team, kind of the whole media team is consisting of, I believe, something around five, six people. And we have the creation part, basically creative, internal creative agency, consisting of another like 5 to 10 people.
All right. Another question by Michael on Eigenmarken, own brands. Do you do these kind of brand stories that you refer to? Do you do those for your own brands already? Are you planning on putting more focus on that? Or is that something you don't really do so much because you can't have it refinanced by another brand?
The Eigenmarken? The own brand?
Yeah.
Within our assortment, you mean?
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah. From a branding perspective, do you put any effort into that?
I mean, we are running. We have an own brand called About You. Then we have another own brand called Edited for young women. And then we are doing a lot of kind of own brand initiatives together with celebrities such as Lena Gerke in Germany, very prominent example, or Guido Maria Kretschmer, where we have built brands together with them that are co-owned by us and them, basically as a joint venture. I saw a question. I was just flipping through the chat here, and I saw two comments. Basically, is this intuition or is there any data behind? You know, it's not intuition. You know, if you know about you from the inside, you know that we are not deciding on intuition. Intuition, nevertheless, plays a role. Yeah, so not everything can be measured. There's always a proportion of intuition with it. So I can't. What is data is you can't build more than 25% brand awareness in the young audience. That is data. The question why, and my two hypotheses on this is, you know, declining TV usage and even more people are not watching at the television. This is intuition. You know, I don't have data on why people don't seem to take notice of the TV advertisement, but for sure they don't. Yeah. So it is the explanation or the hypothesis behind this was intuition by observing, you know, and the result 25% max is data. But, you know, on the other hand, you know, TV stations are very good in, you know, providing with a shitload of data. But I would always, you know, ask, you know, is this data or is this, you know, fucking fake statistics? Yeah. So, yeah. I would always rely also to a certain extent on my gut feeling. If I see a statistics where I don't know anybody who is having that behavior, obviously you need to, you know, deduct a bit of your own bubble, but you know, I would always heavily question stuff I can't see as an observation. Yeah.
There were also some discussions, I think, even in the chat regarding the fact that the industry you are in is very suited to this approach, right? So I think the comments here were made towards the insurance industry. Obviously, it's significantly harder to do the same play in an insurance industry. What are your thoughts on that? I mean, it's not your core focus because you are definitely in the fashion game, but would you think this approach is somewhat applicable to other industries that are less sexy?
For sure. I mean, at the end of the day, you don't reach young people through television. That is true that is even more true for a boring industry, I would say, yeah? Because the likeliness of someone watching to the television when they hear this is an About You spot or a Zalando spot is higher because they kind of refer emotionally to the brand and then, you know, watch the ad because they're interested of what we are basically advertising. If you're kind of in a boring industry, yeah. Then it's even more true. So you just don't reach young people. And as I said, it's not just because they don't watch television anymore. They do, but they don't watch television breaks. Yeah. So when people say, but I know young people are still watching television. Yes, I say the same. Young people are still watching linear television, but they don't watch the fucking television break. And that is the relevant part. If you ask yourself whether the stuff you do in television has any basically relevance for the young audience, and this is true no matter if you're a fashion company or an insurance or you know a car company, you know people just don't watch it. It's like an ad blocker.
What young people are watching though is TikTok. So there are a couple of questions around TikTok and how relevant it is today and also going forward for your marketing mix. I know that also from some of the podcasts you did recently, you're very much intrigued by the TikTok algorithm, but how important is it for About You at this point?
We are playing a lot around with TikTok. I think we have not cracked TikTok yet. I think it's decent for us, but we haven't, you know, had any like crazy successes on TikTok so far. I believe TikTok will become more important. It will get older. At the moment, it's a phenomenon of, you know, very young people and not commercially interested target group, people below age 18. But usually what the behavior of people below age 18 will be adapted by older people. So I think it makes sense to, even though it's not commercially interesting, the target group on TikTok, I think it's important to keep track on what is happening there because it has a high chance of getting relevant also for older audiences.
All right, then maybe last question, which I think is not so easy to answer in a short amount of time. Can you shortly explain how you scale influencer marketing? Because it doesn't scale as performance marketing. The hypothesis behind this question, I think, is do you have to scale the team in a linear way? So maybe some insights on that would be cool.
So it is, we always try to scale stuff through technology and automation. So for example, this database is also crawling Instagram, constantly looking for new influencers, keeping track on growth, keeping track on geographics, basically trying to figure out who has real reach, who has fake reach. Then whenever we do a campaign, we try to, you know, get the real reach, that is measured from Instagram and try to deduct fake reach if they buy fake reach on the Insta stories, for example, which is possible by now. We always try to, you know, measure the direct response, etc. So we try to measure as much as possible. Nevertheless, basically doing a cooperation with a human being always needs a human factor. So that's at the end of the day, we have a workforce of 15 working students basically doing the communication, but they are basically steered by an algorithm. So the algorithm tells them contact this person and offer this amount of money for a cooperation. And then at the end of the day, a person is writing the email, you know. But being basically steered from an algorithm with, I think, 3 to 5 full-time employees and a huge workforce of working students and, you know, junior people basically then basically doing the contact, very much like SEO in the former days. Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much, Tarek. I posted a link and I will repeat that in the chat now for networking with you. One comment, this is based on Wonders. So you just have to click the link, no registration required. Tarek, I would ask you to do the same, please.
Yeah, crazy,
the maximum amount of people that are able to chat with you is 15. So if you're not among the first 15, just wait a couple of minutes until somebody else drops out. I'll also be there. So if you want to talk to me, feel free. So here's the link again. Thanks, Tarek, so much. Thank you, everyone, for joining. I think it's very cool to see so many people on the chat interacting at the same time. So let's now move over to Wonder. Paste the link once again.
Just one short thank you, guys. I mean, 150 comments is incredible. Yeah, I would have loved to answer all of them, but I find it really nice that there was so much interaction. And thanks for listening for such a long time. Yeah.